There are about 40,000 known spider species and potentially thousands more we haven't discovered yet. In their 400 million years of existence, they've spread over every continent and mastered nearly every environment on Earth. Whether you are afraid of spiders or not, you've got to admit that spiders are pretty impressive and well-equipped animals. Let's take a look at the science behind what makes them some of the most successful carnivores in the world. Even though they are tiny, they still have organs, a circulatory system, and even a skeleton. Except that they wear their skeletons on the outside instead of the inside, and this is something called exoskeleton. Spiders also have lungs. Now, they have one of two types of lungs, neither of which is like the human lung. Some spiders have something called book lungs, and a book lung has a stack of soft plates called lamellae, and oxygen passes through the lamellae, diffusing through the tissue and into the blood. Other spiders have trachea, which are basically tiny breathing tubes that allow them to bring air straight into their bodies. As you know, some spiders can be venomous, and when dealing with the effect of spider venom on humans, there are really just two types. Some spider venom is neurotoxic, meaning that it affects the human nervous system beyond the immediate site of the spider bite. The venom of the black widow spider is neurotoxic, thereby causing rigidity, cramp, and paralysis of the sympathetic systems. Other spider venom can be necrotic and causes damage to the tissue surrounding the site of the bite. The recluse spiders, for example, have necrotic venom. The damage usually results in skin blisters and ulcers and blackening of the local tissues. Spiders are famous for their intricate and varied forms of spider webs. Spider silk is a protein that's formed as a liquid by silk glands and squeezed out of something called a spinneret, like toothpaste being squeezed from a tube. The liquid thread hardens as it makes contact with the air and leaves the spinneret, and some types of thread become stronger than steel proportionate to that size. Most of the silk threads in a spider web are actually multiple strands of fine silk lying one alongside the other. The spiders produce several types of silk from different types of spinning glands. One type of silk produced by virtually all spiders is the type used for wrapping their prey. Another type of silk is used to make their egg sac, and yet another is a sticky type often used as part of the spider web. Although spiders are generally known for these webs, that's not the only way they have of catching food. There are three other key methods that spiders use to capture their prey. Firstly, sedentary spiders live inside silk-lined burrows and leap out to capture passing prey. Some normally active spiders lie in ambush on plants or tree bark, on the ground or hidden under stones. Other spiders, like hunter spiders, go in search of their prey using their eight eyes and incredibly sensitive body hairs to detect the slightest of movement in the environment around them. Most spiders have eight simple eyes, which actually perform three different tasks. The two main eyes of a spider each have a simple lens and a retina, which is made of light-sensitive cells whose surfaces point towards the light as it enters the eye. Now, these main eyes have a small field of vision with a very high resolution. They're especially strong in jumping spiders. A spider's secondary eyes also have lens, but the light-sensitive cells of these eyes point away from the light, as do the similar cells in the human eye. The secondary eyes detect shadows and the difference between light and dark. All spiders, of course, travel around their immediate territory on foot, but did you know that some spiders have learnt to fly between their webs? So, there you are. They might be a bit scary to some of us and quite dangerous in some parts of the world, but there's no denying that spiders are a natural marvel. Thanks, guys, and tune in next time for some exciting science, and we'll see you very soon. Bye for now.
Have you ever wondered what a tin of tomatoes, chocolate bars, and broccoli have in common? Is it carbs? No. Proteins? Nope. Fats? Hell no. It's bugs. Yes, the very same creepy crawlies you try to keep out of your house. That's right. Now, here's what you need to know. Bugs, or at least tiny bug bits, are in most of our foods, and there is absolutely nothing unhealthy or unsafe about it. What? Yes, you heard that right. Vegans and vegetarians, you're probably going to have to reconsider eating veggies, as the harsh fact is that you do consume up to 1 to 2 pounds of cockroaches, flies, maggots, and other creepy crawlies hidden in your food every year. Ugh. Our produce and canned foods are full of little bug bits. Everything from broccoli to spinach to canned tomatoes can contain heads, legs, thoraxes, and even entire insects. At this point, you're probably thinking, how is this even allowed? Is this safe? Well, the FDA has a handbook for levels of natural and unavoidable defects in foods that present no health hazards to humans. Almost everything that we consume has a certain amount of bug parts in it that the FDA has deemed okay for human consumption, including health food, junk food, snacks, and drinks. Yeah, that's right. Let's look at some more shocking facts. Up to 8 bug parts are legally allowed by the FDA in each chocolate bar. Eating 100 pounds of chocolate would mean that you could have consumed up to 1 pound of bugs. So next time you want to gift someone special a box of chocolates, think again. Eating 100 pounds of bread would mean you could have consumed up to 1.5 pounds of bugs. Bugs are even in certain drinks. Did you know? Up to 5% of the hops in each batch of beer is bugs. So next time you go out to grab a few cold ones, ask the bartender for a bug beer. In every can measuring 3.5 ounces, up to 19 maggots and 74 mites are allowed. That slice of red velvet you love so much contains carmine, a vibrant red food colorant which is made from the crushed abdomens of female, beetle-like African insects. For centuries, people have consumed bugs. Everything from locusts to beetles, termites, caterpillars, and dragonflies. This even has a name, entomophagy. Almost 2,000 species of insects are consumed across Asia, Africa, Mexico, and South America. This includes 235 species of butterflies and moths, 344 beetles, 313 ants, bees, and wasps, 239 grasshoppers, crickets, and cockroaches, 39 termites, and 20 dragonflies, as well as cicadas. Somebody call the exterminator! Now, let's look at some of the benefits of consuming these bugs we're running away from. Insects are a more sustainable source of protein for the growing population across the planet, as opposed to the more widely accepted protein sources. In addition to the protein, insects are also a great source of energy-rich fat, fiber, vitamins, and minerals. The risk of disease or a virus like swine flu is decreased, since insects are genetically very different from humans. The environmental impact of farming insects for food is far lower than livestock farming, since they produce fewer greenhouse gases and require 95% less water. 80% of a cricket's body is edible, as opposed to just 40% of a cow's and 50% of a chicken's body. So the fact is that bugs might be the best way to feed our growing population, which is growing at an alarming rate. The demand for meat-based protein is also rising. If everyone starts eating as much meat as Americans do, that would require more land area than even exists on the planet. Well, if you get over the yuck factor, you could be making a smart choice by adding some of these insects to your diet. What do you think?